Hi, I'm Joe and welcome to the channel. In this micro lesson, I wanted to explore how to practice the cage system on guitar. I'm sure you're familiar with the cage system. There's tons of videos here on YouTube that explore that whole system, but I started practicing it and I realized, you know, we can probably break this down into actually smaller chunks to get started at first and then slowly build up into the full patterns. So I wanted to share that concept with you in this micro lesson. Let me go ahead and grab a guitar and we'll get started. So most likely if you're watching this video, you're already familiar with the cage system. And if you're not, I do encourage you to look it up. It's a way to navigate the fretboard based off of all the open chord shapes that you're probably used to, which is obviously spells the word cage. So you have your C, your A, your G, your E, and your D chord shapes. But when you move them across the neck in one key is where you can find all the fingerings for that specific key that you're working in. Now, the first thing that you generally learn, though, with these shapes is you learn the whole entire thing, which can be a little bit overwhelming. So what if we took the caged idea and we broke it down into even simpler bite-sized chunks? The first one being just looking at where the root note is for all of the different shapes. And remember, there's five shapes. So for the first shape, which would be the C shape, when we're looking at this, just find the root C for now, which is the third finger on the third fret of the A string, and your first finger on the first fret of the B string. Now that's shape one of the cage system, right? Shape two would be your A chord, but slid up to find now the second shape. And let's again find the roots. The root again is on the third fret of the A string, and then the fifth fret of the G string. Moving up now to the G chord. We take our G chord and we slide it up where our note is now on C here. We have C here, which is on the seventh fret of the low E string. I'm sorry, five, six, eight. I can't count today. It's on the eighth fret of the low E string. The fifth fret of the G string, and again the octave on the eighth fret of the high E string, because obviously that's the same pitch, just up two octaves. Now we're taking our E shape, we're sliding it up to our C shape position here, and what do we find? Where do we find the roots here? First finger again on the eighth fret, then on the tenth fret on the D string we have our C here, and then the octave up. Same thing as you saw from the low E happens here. Now when we move up, we have our D shape, and instead of playing it like this, obviously if we're gonna do the cage system, we would have this, take this, slide it up to your C. So now where are your octaves here? Well, we have the 10th fret of the D string, and now the 13th fret of the B string. So let's go over those shapes. Shape one again. Shape two. Shape three. Shape four. And shape five. Now, the first thing that we should notice when we're doing this is there's notes that overlap each shape to connect them. So you're not hunting around all the time to find where they are, but let's look where those are, right? So for the first shape, the C shape, number one, it's our third finger that becomes the first part of the second shape. The common note in the third shape is this note here on the fifth fret of the G string. So we have to do obviously a hand shift, position shift, but that's where they're joined together, is on this note. The next shape is joined off of where that first note was, but with your first finger now. And there's two overlapping with that one, right? We have this one, we have this, and this. Same thing here. We're just adding this other octave in. And then the final shape, the fifth shape, is joined by this note here. So I hope you can see that. This then becomes the second shape. this is a part of the third shape. These two are part of the fourth shape. And this one is part of the fifth shape. So that's great. Now we can see that. We can see how that moves around. And obviously, it just repeats itself. When we go back to the first shape up here, our pinky, where our pinky is, will become part of this shape again. And then it repeats. So, we know now where the roots are. And what's nice about this is, we can slowly practice just memorizing those simple shapes. And now you know where all the roots are for this. And that's great. So now, what's the next step? Well, the next step is let's start building off of these root notes. If you know a little bit of music theory, we can talk about how to build chords. And the chord is always built off of the root, the third, and the fifth. So why don't we start adding that into the mix? So with the first shape here, let's do a basic C arpeggio. Root, third, which is E, and then the fifth is the open G string. And if we want to put the octave on top, we can, which is our first finger. If you're not familiar how to build chords, I made a whole micro lesson on this, and I'll put one of those cards up there. So we have that going for that shape. Same thing will apply for the next shape. Let's build that again. Root, third, fifth. Root, third, fifth. So you can see here we're quickly building arpeggios in these shapes. Now the next shape up, right? Where did that start? Right here. So again, the root, third, fifth, root, third, fifth, and the root again. And we can do the same thing on the next pattern, right? So what's nice about just learning these shapes is that we can apply any tonality to them. And what I mean by that is, well, we were building off major triads off of the first time around. What if we wanted to do minor triads? Well, if we know the formula of a minor triad, which is taking the third and making it a flat three, we can use the same shapes that we're already familiar with now and build those as well in the same types of positions. So we can go C, E flat, G, C. So now we have the minor arpeggio happening. All right, so we basically took our open shapes, our basic shapes with just the roots. We started to fill in with triads, and you can practice that with major and minor triads and any type of flavor that you want. And then the next step is, well, let's go ahead and add a major pentatonic scale to the mix, right? Now we're starting to fill in the pattern again with five notes out of the seven notes that make up a major scale. So let's do that. We'll take this pattern here. And we know, if you know the formula for a major pentatonic scale, it's the root, the second, the third, the fifth, and the sixth scale degree. So we have root, the second, the third, the fifth, and the sixth scale degree, and the octave. And we're all familiar with that sound, right? But we can do that in any of the shapes now that we know the formula, right? Root, second, third, fifth, sixth, and then the octave. So you can quickly see where I'm going with this, I think. You can do this with your major and your minor pentatonics, just again, based off of the root shapes, those five different root shapes all over the neck. So once you kind of figure this out, starting by practicing maybe in the key of C, then move to a different key. Maybe try the key of F. And if you do that, you're starting with the fourth pattern of those different five patterns that we started with in the beginning. So we'll be having, which would then go into the fifth pattern, which would start over now with the first pattern, to the second pattern, to the third pattern, and then it repeats itself. So hopefully that's helpful to you. All we're doing is breaking down kind of the cage system into smaller bite-sized chunks for our brains to kind of wrap around, and then start building and filling in the gaps from there. And I hope that you can take this kind of as a concept that you can apply to anything else that you're learning on the guitar. Always see if you can break things down maybe to their basic element first, and then start building in and filling in the gaps. Well, that's another micro lesson down. If you found any value in this video whatsoever, please do me a favor and consider helping me grow the channel by subscribing down below and hitting the like button. These things help me out, and I'm very grateful for that. As always, I wish you a wonderful day.